see it come in. Excuse me, 1 minute. John Bocius.
How you doing, Frank?
Chicago. Tommy Fantella? What was his name? Tommy Fontanella?
Bobby Fontanella. He wanted me to show, he wanted, no, he said, show me yours. No, that really happened when I was a kid. I went down to Sullivan with a Greek girl. She had a delicatessen on the corner, and I did. She showed me hers, and I did show her my brother's. I really did. I took out a little thing. I said, "Show her." Everything comes from truth, right? I want to say hello to Mr. Tony Sirico, my very, very dear friend. Mr. Bobby Montoya from Question of the Movie. Tell me. Yeah. And Nick Puccio's here. And who am I leaving out? I'm leaving out the producers of the fabulous Chicago Overcoat. Who else did I leave out? Frankie Jacupo, the very first guy that I played my first job with as a drummer, is here tonight. Mr. Frankie Kubo. The one picture you saw me with the guy with the accordion, that's him. That was in 1950. Victor Calicchio, how are you? Miss Kamina is here. And she is. I guess you only have one mic, John.
Yeah, it's low budget.
I could tell by how long it took to get in there.
You know, let's go. Joey D'Onofrio is here, also, ladies and gentlemen. Frank, let's go back to the Vincent and Pesci days. You know, a lot of people, when I talk about Frank and I tell them, you know, Frank's a world-class drummer, and he had a band with Joe Pesci. So I want you to tell the story about what your act was like and about the one-hit single you had.
Holy shit. Well, I had a band 10 years before I met Joe. The band that you saw, the quartet and then the quintet, was before Joe. Then we cut down to a trio. And in the summer of July 1969, my piano player left and I needed somebody to replace him. The guy down the seashore, are you lost, sir? Sit down, you're blocking me. The guy down the seashore bought a brand new piano because he knew I was going to hire a piano player. And Joe Pesci used to come and sit in when I was playing at another club in Newark, New Jersey. And I said, Joe, you want to go to work? He said, yeah, how much? I told him. He said, okay. And he came with a little guitar, a little amplifier about this big, and a guitar with one pick. You don't understand. One pick, if you drop the pick, you can't play the guitar. And the rug was red, and the pick was red. So we had to send somebody around the corner where some other band was playing to borrow a pick, or if you broke a string. So that's true. So Joe and I got together, and before you know it, we were making a lot of people laugh, and we became comedians. We had stand-up comedy, and we opened for a few people, and we had a great time up and down the coast. And what was the question?
The hit single.
Well, the hit single was, Can You Fix the Way I Talk for Christmas? Joe did a real good impression of Porky Pig. So we did Porky Pig. Can you fix the way I talk for Christmas? I said, "Go, oh, 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 little boy." And they played it in New York. William B. Williams played it. And he got a complaint from the Stuttering Association. And they took it off the air. Now the sequel to that is I did a commercial 2 years ago for Miller Lite for the basketball season, and Mike Starr and I played two mobsters, and the Italian Association took it off the air. So that the end of those residuals.
Frank, you know, look, I've worked with you a lot as an actor, and you know, you have a timing that has got to come from your musical background. Did you have any kind of formal acting training when you got into acting?
No. Actually, when you're doing, you're standing in two with a partner, and you're doing skits that you wrote yourself, and you're in front of this many people, and they're not listening to you, they're drinking and having a party, you press it, and you press it, and you press it, and before you know it, you learn what is going to take to have you stop and listen to me? And that's the lesson of acting. It's, and plus, to be a musician, you have to be able to hear, and to be an actor, you have to be able to hear. So the two combined, it only took 15 years to become an actor. 1970, when did we do our first movie? Well, not before Raging Bull.
My first movie was 90.
Yeah, so 79, I did Raging Bull. Before that was Death Collector. So 70, 78, I started playing music in 19. So that would took 20 years to get there. Not bad. 20 years of getting killed on the stage.
And okay, in between that, you chopped off Eric Roberts' finger, his thumb.
Yeah.
In the
Pope of Greenwich Village, yes. With Mickey Rourke. That's what Mickey Rourke looked like, Mickey Rourke. Don't say ooh. Mickey, we just had a little thing in Las Vegas, myself, Mickey Rourke, James Caan, and my very good friend Tony Sirico. We opened the Las Vegas Mob Experience, which is a big museum now taking place in the Tropicana Hotel. And Mickey came on, he bought a little hat, and he just went out there and did his thing. But Mickey's Mickey, and he'll always be Mickey. So we just accept him the way he is. But he looked different in that movie.
You guys saw the photograph of Frank when he had the musical act with the kind of, you know, Mr. Cotter hair and the big bushy mustache. Now I believe that's the picture that Martin Scorsese saw.
Yeah.
That's what you looked like when Marty met you, and yet, you know, genius that is, he could see, you know, underneath.
Well, Sis Corman cast Raging Bull. And I was sent by Marvin Josephson, the late Marvin Josephson, who was my first agent. Victor, you know who that is. He was a very old Jewish guy that booked bands. And I wound up with him because of Frankie. He played in a movie with us. Frank, I just saw him in Vegas.
Adonis.
Frank Adonis. Yeah, yeah. So Sis Corman got me an interview to read for Marty Scorsese. And I had to go to Park Avenue in a hotel. And I went upstairs and rang the bell, and who opened the door but Bob De Niro. Mm-hmm. He said, "Hi, Bob." He said, "Hi, Frank." I said, "I loved you in Deer Hunter." He said, "I loved you in Death Collector." And we went in. Marty was there, Joe was there. We moved all the furniture, and we did the scene where Joe and I were walking in the street, the scene you just saw. And I had an afro, and I had a mustache. Mm-hmm. 2 days later, a week later, I was leaving for Las Vegas for a vacation, and I got a call that they wanted to do a screen test. They wanted to test me for the part of Salvi. But you have to cut all your hair off. You have to cut off your mustache. Just to do a screen test. You guys don't know you play in the band. What do you know about screen tests? These are my friends that all played music with me together. So you had to go. I said, cut it off. And we went. And I was in the middle of the desert. And I called the casting director 3 days later and said, "You got Raging Bull."
Wow.
I didn't know even what that was about. So I was on the whole show for the whole day. Every week I got my check. I joined the union, and I was an actor.
Did you know?
Did
you know it was going to be, you know, talk to us about your experience with Marty and Bob on that movie. Of course, you knew Joe already.
Yeah. Well, Marty's a very slick guy. He's a very, very smart man, and he's a detailed man. He watches, he sees everything. So he saw between Joe and I, he saw the chemistry that we had just from playing music together and doing comedy. So when we would go to the set to do a shot, we would get to the set and look at it and say, "What do you want to do? I don't know, what do you want to do? Here's the script," and go over it. He saw what we had, and we had a little bit of thing here, a little bit of thing here. Marty took advantage of that, and he used it 3 times. He used it for that, and he used it for Casino and Goodfellas. I mean, the scene in Goodfellas, we played that back. We must have did it 20 times, 18 times. Every time, the timing was perfect between Joe and I. I go home and get your shine box. It was just something that we achieved, and it was to our benefit because you know, you work with actors. I mean, Tony Sirico and I worked a lot of shows together, but we have chemistry, so it's easy to work with Tony or Victor. People that you know good and you can, but Marty took advantage of that, and it's, you know, the actors come from very different places. Who comes from from Shakespeare, who comes from this, who comes from that, and you meet them for the first time, and then you got to play, like tonight, I met my daughters.
Yeah, for Fickle.
Right, for Fickle, the movie that we're going to be doing. I have two beautiful young ladies, but I had two daughters, so I got to understand that a little bit. But that's the difference. Working with Marty and Joe and Bob is easy, because we've done it so many times, and we have the relationship.
Frank, let me ask, there's a lot of actors in the audience tonight. Has your approach to your craft changed since you started?
No, it's never changed. It's always been what it is. And I don't think I can even tell you what it is as far as how to do it. Most of the stuff that you get to do is written on a page. These two young guys right here, they made a script, and they sent the script to me, and I liked the script. I liked what they wrote. They said they wrote it for me, which is another compliment, but even if they didn't write it for me, I still like the script. So that script is going to tell me how I have to perform this particular action or this particular situation that the character is in. And I find the way I do it is I just read it and study it and get to a point where I don't have to think about saying it. It just comes out of my mouth because it's got to be easy. You can't, if it's forced out of your mouth, the camera will tell on you and you're dead. You know, it's a lie.
Well, that's, you know, many of the films that we've done together, we sit down, we have a reading like most movies do with all the actors. And if the actor, you know, reads a different line than what I've written, he's always going to be right. The actor's generally always going to be right. And that's been invaluable working with you, you know. Where you know how to take a line of dialogue and make it your own.
Interestingly enough, that's true in film. But when you do Sopranos and you sit in a room for the read through for the next episode, and they give you your pages, they give you the script, and then they give everybody a script, they put a number on it, and you got to give it back after the reading. You read the script. And then when you're going to do the acting, if you change the, it, and, or, of, you got to call headquarters. Every word that we said in Sopranos was written. So that's a different kind of a method. It's because the writing was just unbelievable. Unbelievable, the writing. I mean, when you get that opportunity to do something like that, you don't want to change nothing because it fits you. I mean, I got stories about David Chase. He made my girlfriend in the show Ukrainian because I had dinner with David. He met my wife. My wife's Ukrainian. And he sticks to the reality of who you are, so you don't have to go too far from yourself to do something. That's genius. That's a very intelligent way of doing things.
The two pictures that you've done with Spike Lee, Spike is a very improvisatory director. Talk first about that amazing scene from Do the Right Thing, which I believe was all improv?
Mostly. Well, prior to what you saw here, I'm in a Cadillac convertible, and the car is lined with plastic. So when you get in the car, you're sitting, they close the door and they fill it with water. Car is filled with water, so when you get in the car, you're sitting in water, and you can work the gas and the brake. Cha-Cha, you're late. Don't ever be late for a show that I'm doing again, Cha-Cha. My consigliere on Sopranos.
Complain John Salvato for that.
Where's Salvato?
He called me just now. He's a...
And he's in the go home and get your shine box scene. The little guy sitting there. And the other guy, by the way, I don't want to get away from Spike Lee's story, is the singer from, Chach?
Dupree's.
No.
Vito
and the Salutation. The guy with the beard?
Vito and the Yellow Guns.
Vito and the Yellow Guns. Okay. So Spike Lee. What am I saying?
Okay, talk about how you met Spike, how Spike called you.
Okay, I got a phone call. My wife's best friend was going out with a black guy. I don't know why, but she was there. No disrespect, son. I'm sorry. No, I wasn't talking to you. I was talking to a black guy. Some mulatto. He wants to take me out. He said, we think he's black. Anyway. See, you shouldn't open your mouth. This is tough. You get killed here. Been doing this 25 years. Anyway, phone rings, I answer the phone. Hello, Frank Vincent? Yes, this is Spike Lee. I said, okay. He says, I'm a director. I said, are you Chinese? Spike Lee is a Chinese name. I don't care what anybody says. He said, no, he says, I'm black. I said, are you doing the black movie? He said, no, I'm doing a regular movie. He said, and he said, Martin Scorsese asked me to call you. I said, yes, sir, Mr. Lee, what can I do for you? And I went and I read for him for this role. And it starts out where the kids are playing with the fire hydrants. In fact, that kid's famous now, the comedian. He's got his own show.
And Martin Lawrence.
Martin Lawrence, yeah. And they're shooting the water across. And I'm coming down the street. And I said, oh, turn the fire hydrant off. I'm coming through. I don't want to get wet. No, man, come on, man. No, turn it off. So he turns it off. I'm going through. And he lets it go. Now, as I said, I'm sitting already in water. This is how it's set up. So I got to pull the car over, get out of the car, and they had the shot on the floor so that you see the water come out. Did that about four times, by the way. And then the cops came, and Spike said, we got to rehearse with the cops. I said, what are we going to rehearse? He said, they're going to come and ask you what happened. You know, he wrote the two black guys wet the car and so on and so forth. I said, no, I don't want to rehearse. So we didn't rehearse. And then I just got out of the car screaming, soaking wet. That'll make you act that way when you're soaking wet. It'll make you act that, like, you know, you want to kill somebody. But I'm sitting in water for 2 days. Did you get their names? Yeah, did I get their names? That's a good question. Did I get their names? Yeah, Mo and Joe. He said, did you get their last names? I said, yeah, Mo and Joe Black. How's that? And that was Danny Aiello's son, by the way.
Ricky
Aiello, yes. It was the other cop who did the fire hydrant. But that was the first meeting I had with Spike. And then he called me in to do Jungle Fever. I don't know how many of you have seen that movie, Jungle Fever. It's a pretty harsh movie. Annabella Ciara plays my daughter, and I play a bigoted Italian guy from Brooklyn, which is, I guess, not a big departure. I don't know. You can believe what you want, but I like black people. Rosie, who do you love, Rosie? My accountant's here, please. She can still get paid. You stand up comedy, that was. So Spike said, so there's a lot of language in that where when she comes home from shopping, I smack her and I said, the black man, how could you go with a black man? You did this to him, you did that. I mean, literally very, very lewd stuff. And I said to Spike, you got a problem with that because the whole crew is black. Spike's people are all black. I said, no, I got no problem with Spike. He said, I got no problem either. And we went and we did it, and it worked. And I had to whip her with the strap. But she was great. Annabella was great, yeah.
You mentioned the hip-hop community loves you, adores you. I mean, you did some of the great, and Nas is a great video. Mm-hmm. You were in Hype Williams' movie Belly.
Yeah, yeah.
Talk about some of that.
Well, I got a phone call from somebody's manager. I think Nas's manager or something called me and said that they're doing this movie Belly. The hip hoppers are doing this movie with Hype Williams. Hype Williams is one of the biggest directors of videos for all the a lot of the black rappers and whatever. And they said they interviewed six guys that they fired to be a coach. They wanted somebody to coach these guys in this movie, and they wanted a real guy to coach them. They didn't want just an acting professor. So they hired me, they thought I was a real guy. And I went and I did it, and I was 60 days on the show with Hype and DMX and Blunts at 8 o'clock in the morning. And cognac and dogs, they bring dogs to the set. One time, DMX was gone for 3 days. There was 400 people in Reverend Ike's theater. But the cameraman was sitting like this, the director was sitting like this, they couldn't find him. So he just stayed home. And he came 3 days later and they shot it. And they lost the movie like four times, but they got it back. And it's a good movie. That's my. My thing was, we had a scene in a little room with gunplay, you know, and they use real guns, but they use blanks. And They gave each one of these kids a gun. I said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go outside and stay by the video, and I'll watch the scene from there. I ain't staying in the room with four guys that's this big, that they got pistols that could knock your eye out with it, you know? So we had a good time doing that. It was fun.
Now, you also, I guess, like during the 90s, you started doing a lot of TV, Law and Order and Civil Wars, and any kind of difference, any kind of transition that started that?
Well, a TV is a different animal, that, especially 1 hour TV shows. That they shoot that in 6 days, I think, 6 or 7 days. Monday usually till Saturday. And then Sunday the new script comes out for the next week. So that's really, really guerrilla filmmaking. As opposed to Sopranos, they shot Sopranos like in 15 days, 16 days. And it was almost an hour show, but they shot it like a movie. So it was a different pressure and a different feeling. Today, they're still shooting them the same way. I mean, I did the Walker, Texas Ranger. I had to go to Dallas, Texas, and I had to kill somebody from a helicopter. And they put a helicopter on a stand, and you get in the helicopter, and they make the thing go around a little bit. You're shooting a little 45, you're supposed to be flying in the air, I'm killing people. Right, don't kill somebody. And the weather was so bad, that it was all mud, that we had to go and work a day over the limit, and they had to pay us from the morning, the minute we got up in the morning, to the minute we got back to our homes at night. That's the kind of penalties they had to pay for going overtime.
Okay, so Goodfellas, everybody knows the scene, it's a classic. How long did you shoot that scene? Was there any improv in that? Was it scripted? And how many days did you stay in the car?
Well, Goodfellas, I just came off a back operation, and I only worked, I think I worked 4 days, 5 days on Goodfellas, totally, that's all. And we shot that in, I think, the Bronx, and I was sitting in a bar stool most of the time with a big thing on my back for that, because all the stuff that I did on the floor was done by Peter Percosi, who was the stunt coordinator for Sopranos. And there's a lot of aside stories. Peter Percosi, he was a stuntman. My son lost his job. He wanted to be a stuntman, and he's got all kinds of black belt credits. And I brought him to Peter on set. I said, Peter, I want you to meet my son. He met him, and he gave him the next episode of Sopranos. When Johnny Sack got locked up, the kid was one of the FBI guys. And then he was one of the guys that shot Dr. Dan. Anyway, Peter Bocosi's a hell of a guy. He's a big, big talent. He did all the stuff on the floor. He did all the stuff in the trunk. I was in the trunk only one time. That night I spent in the trailer, and we heard them outside. Boom, 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 you son of a bitch, man. All night long. And then he said, okay, Vince, bring Vincent in. And they put the blood and everything. I had to get in. And that's when I had to do some one line in the trunk. No, Joey, don't do whatever I said, I don't remember. So now I'm out socially after the movie comes out with some people and a woman, a school teacher. She says, let me ask you a question. It's a school teacher, educated woman. She says, when you were in the trunk and they were inside eating, how could you breathe? She said. I said, what did you say? I said, I had a straw. I didn't need a straw. But that's the reality. That's when people really, that's when you know you're doing the job, because they believe it. Because you heard the thumping, you know. And they was getting the knife and everything.
Okay, so in Raging Bull, you know, Pesci beats you with the cab door. They stomp you in Goodfellas, but you get your revenge in Casino after the cornfield. Talk about shooting that. That must have been a brutal scene to shoot.
Yeah, it was a brutal scene. I just got to say something about Raging Bull. In order to make that scene work, I had to get, they padded me all up. And Jim Nickerson was the stunt coordinator for that. He did all the fight stuff. And I had to get in the car, and he had to slam me with the car door. But I was padded. And there was a woman in the car. And the woman was going, ooh, ooh. And the guy said, scream. He said, you were hitting me with the door, scream. Ooh, ooh. He got a long stick. Scream! Scream! She couldn't react. She knew it was fake, but they got it to work. Right? Okay, what was the question?
Your revenge on Joe.
On Joe. Well, okay. What really happened in that story is not Frank Culotta, the character I played in that movie, did not kill Tony Spilotro. He was killed in a Kansas City cornfield by other people. But Spilotro was from Chicago. So it took a little artistic license, and they made Frank Culotta, my character, kill him. So I said to Marty, you know, how are you, because we got out of the car and we started hitting them bats and everything, and Joey was all bloody laying on the ground. I said, Marty, what? He said, just think of it as the end of a friendship. The end of, because Frank Culotta said to me personally, he said, I love Tony Spilotro more than I loved anybody in my life. So that phrase, that you're gonna kill somebody like that, you have to have that kind of sensitivity in you. And that's what made the scene work. And we also have here someone here from the casino that's sitting with us in the audience tonight. My very good friend, Al. Al, stand up, take a bow. Alfred Bentoli. Casino was a lot of fun. We spent 4 months in Las Vegas. And they have slot machines in the toilets and in the airports. And when you go shopping for your food, you come out, there's a slot machine. Think, let me take a shot. Right, Ron?
Right.
But we had a good time in doing the casino. It was a lot of fun. And the cornfield that we used in that, it was winter, it was cold, and they had the heaters. And the cornfield was fake. And they had all fake corn growing on an iron bar. They could move anywhere they wanted it for the camera angles. And they dug the hole. And we actually threw in Joe's double. So we threw in the hole. But then you see, what you see is a dummy that moves. They had pumped air because when the dirt hit him, you saw the dirt fly out. That was really a fake, it was a dummy. Well, I figured out how to use it to activate it. But they pump air through it.
Hydraulic.
And it just goes. It's amazing what you think you see, but you don't see a lot of realism. It's all make believe. It's all done with cameras and
hard work.
A lot of time. Todd, time.
Do you see dailies on a Scorsese movie? No.
I never see dailies.
At all?
No. But now they have the video, what do they call it?
Village.
Video Village. You can go and see. I still don't want to see them. Yeah. Listen, you're gonna direct me? You direct me. I don't want to direct me. Your eyes are what makes me work, and whatever you say to me is what. I try not to start too big, because it's hard to go back from big, so I start little. And if you want it bigger, we make it bigger. I mean, that's the way I work. So for me to see it and play it back and me to criticize it, It's not conducive to good work. We're wasting time.
Absolutely.
And you can't waste time. You got to make money.
You get a bottle of water for that.
Salud. Any questions for Frank? Yes.
All your characters, which is your favorite, and which do you think portray the message that you would like to send in your lifelong?
Favorite character.
A message? I'll give you a message. Go home and get your shine box. Because on my website,
the biggest.
On my website, I have something that's called a mobblehead, not a bobblehead. It's Billy Batts in a bobblehead doll that says to you, "Go home and get your shine box. Get those Irish hoodlums a drink, and nobody's breaking up my party." So that's my favorite line because that makes me money. You know what I'm saying?
You're not retiring anytime soon, are you?
You retiring anytime soon?
Oh.
You're not
going to
be, are you?
Waiter, Usher, take this. Retiring? Why would I retire?
No,
I get paid a lot of money to do what I do.
Soon, are you?
I got to be a pain in the ass. Can you bother me outside on the
bar? Yes,
inside.
What's the effect of being older now that you're now that the film industry is growing and we're all growing, and how do you find getting parts and maturing into the industry?
How are we finding parts?
Finding parts of getting older, getting parts.
I'm getting older, and I can't play
Any of them.
I can play an Italian guy, an older Italian guy. I can play an Italian cowboy. I can't play a rapper, a black rapper, that's for sure. You know, as you get older and your parts get less, there's less parts for you, because today it's all young kids are on television and all the reality. Oh my God, reality shows is destroying. What do people want to be entertained by? I don't understand.
Jersey Shore.
Jersey. All right, you get out too. Guys. Anyway, I think he was.
Hey, Bubba, you're in one of my favorite comedies. You're in two quick scenes, Easy Money. How did you get involved with Easy Money?
Well, Joe did that movie. It's a good movie, Rodney Dangerfield. And I think I got it probably because Joe was in it and they asked me to come and read it. And I did two scenes. One scene with the overcoat, right?
Right.
And was the one scene in the boxing ring?
No. I believe so. It was just a couple of quick scenes, but I remember you clearly from the movie. It's one of my favorite comedies.
I got lucky on that show. I grabbed a girl on that show.
Yes,
she came home with me. Yeah. I get residuals. You get. By the way, you get residuals for everything you do. To be a member of Screen Actors Guild, to belong to the greatest union that there is, and anything that you see on television that I've been in, or Tony Sirico's been in, or anybody's been in, the check comes in the mail. And I have a very big love affair with my mailbox. And when I'm in Florida, I have people taking care of my mail, and I get a big envelope and it says, Jackpot. And my lovely Rosie and Anthony and Bobby and this very lovely girl, I forgot your name.
Jen.
I'm sorry, they take care of me pretty good. And I love them very much.
Ernie.
What's your favorite film of all time?
Favorite film?
Go home and get your shine box. No. You know, my favorite film is True Romance.
Yeah, that's a good one.
True Romance. That's Scott.
Tony Scott.
Jimmy Gandolfini. That's Jimmy's big movie that got him off.
Mr. Walken Hopper.
Chris Walken. Dennis Hopper. May rest in peace. I did a movie with Dennis that came out. In Florida, I don't know, with Sly Stallone's brother. Anyway. Yes, sir.
How would you like to play Caesar?
Who?
Caesar.
Who's Caesar?
From Italy.
I don't know. You mean do like Roman stuff?
Yeah.
Why? How much? I think it needs a lot of money to do that.
I mean, that's very nice legs.
Yes, sir.
If you could have a character devised for you, which would be the next role that you would like to play?
If I could have it designed?
Any character. Which would be the next role in a major film that you would like to play?
If it was a character that could be creative for you to play.
It's a character now that's coming up in a movie called Fickle. We have our producer here with us and our investor people, yes. And we have our lovely girls who are playing my daughter. Stand up, honey. She's playing one of my daughters, and where's Broccolini? Broccolini's here. Stand up, honey.
She's in the bathroom.
Oh, she went to the bathroom. And go ahead.
And Ryan O'Callaghan, who co-wrote it. I just want to say something about Fickle. This is a picture that Ryan and I wrote for Frank, in which we wanted to take Frank's kind of gangster iconography and turn it inside out. Ryan plays a kid who goes to work for him, for a guy who may or may not be a gangster. At the kind of the root of a lot of this is the fact that I'm, despite my last name, I'm 3/4 Italian. Many Italian American businessmen I've known who are, you know, honest, hardworking people would sometimes be, you know, suspected of being connected to the mob because they're successful. This is an undercurrent of this project. So we expect a big award from the Knights of Columbus next year.
Keeping with that thought, anybody you meet in Chicago, anybody is related to Al Capone. How you doing? My cousin's wife was Al Capone's wife's third wife's hairdresser. No shit, that's terrific. Because you know what? People want to, for some reason, the Italian guys want to be connected. That's true, no? About Casino, Casino. I'm in Chicago shooting the movie, and my assistant, my little Chinese assistant, took me to a restaurant. I had a Chinese assistant. Why? Something wrong with that?
Any relation to Spike Lee?
No. So I go to this restaurant, and I'm sitting having dinner with my friend. The woman who owns it is an elderly Italian lady. She comes over to the table. Same thing like the girl said, how could you breathe? She said, it's a shame what you did to those guys, the way you put them in that dirt, and you killed them, and you put them in the hole. I knew their wives, they were all widows. How could you do that? This woman owns the two Spalaccio people. I said, I don't know, I just did it. I said, I didn't know I was going to get beat up for it. But people, they really take that personal, especially the Italians, you know.
Stefano, you had a question?
Yeah, of all your, of all the movies, all the scenes that you did, which scene was the toughest one you had as an actor, and why? And how did you get over it?
I probably haven't gotten over it yet. Now, a very tough scene I had to do in Gotti, which was an HBO movie starring Armando Asante, Tony Sirico was in it, a lot of the guys. In fact, that was the preview for The Sopranos on HBO. All the guys from Sopranos, Dominic was in it. Anyway, I had to do a scene with Billy Forsythe, who was playing Sam Gravano, Sammy the Bull. We're sitting at his desk. And it was Sam Gravano, he killed 18 people in real life. So he was assassinating a lot of people. So they figured out a way for me to get killed in this scene. So what they did was they had a desk, and the desk they put the cushion on it so you could fall on it. And they put a wire from the back of my head through my arm into a cup, a demi-tasse cup, and I had a blood thing in my mouth that you, when you get shot, you break it in
squid.
Now, the guy that's gonna shoot me is shooting a gun that shoots the flame backwards. So I said to the guy with the gun, I said, can I see that gun? You're gonna put it next to my head and shoot it? I said, you know what, let's put it next to your head first. And we'll see how it works. All the time. Yeah. So we had now we gotta time this thing so that when he shoots the gun, you gotta imagine the bullet going through my mouth and hitting the cup and splitting. It just was so tedious because the guy was an extra. He wasn't even a regular actor, he was just an extra. And he had to go one, two, three, click, okay. One, two, three, click. One, two, click, no. One, two, three, click. One, two, three. So we had to get him to a point because this was a dangerous scene because the cup could break. You get stuff in your eyes, it's flame involved. And that was a tough scene to do. And because of the effects of it, yeah. He was probably speaking dramatically. Telling the story was a tough scene.
That was right.
Paul?
Yeah. Who's your favorite comedian working now?
Favorite comedian working now?
I like Chris Rock.
Yeah.
Where are you going?
Just to pee.
Just to pee. Hurry up, honey. Hurry up. We'll wait. Maybe we can hear it. These are the kind of jokes I used to do, folks. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that reminds me of the last clip you saw on the reel was short from something that Frank and Tony Sirico and I did, Tony Darrow, Michael Girioli, called Vinny D, and in which Frank played a kind of Ralph Cramden-esque character and his twin sister, Jeanette. I proposed to Frank that, hey, listen, let's do a whole thing in drag. And he went out with the makeup girl, McCarthy, and he shaved his hands, and he got the manicure, he got the pantyhose, the wig, the whole thing. And he was like, wow, this is great. This is like real acting over here, right? And we're in the makeup room the day of, and Tony Sirico's sitting with us. And slowly, as Frank is making the transformation, his his mood is changing a little bit. I don't know, maybe this was Tony was like, say, oh, you're the ugliest broad I ever saw. I asked Tony to leave the room for till we finish up. And then Frank excused himself to go to the men's room.
I'll segue that. So now here I am with this, I got stockings on, Hutskin. Thigh highs, they call it. I got a corset on, and I got fake bra, fake boobs in there. And I got a blouse on, down to here, and jewelry and nail polish, and a wig that we had to do 4 days of fitting the wig and the whole thing. And we went shopping for clothes, and we went to a gay shoe store. And they have on the walls boots. Size 18. These are for guys. Not for women, they're for men. And so we dressed it up. And now we're in, we got it all made up, and I'm ready to go on camera. I said, John, I gotta go to the bathroom. So I got nail polish on there. So the bathroom is like a rectangular shaped thing with a mirror here, a little counter, and the John is in the back. So I walk in. Come on, honey. You want to sit down?
Yes.
Come on, you got toilet paper. I'm only kidding. You're a good sport, honey. So I walk into this bathroom. Just want to do my business. But I'm all in drag. And my hands, they're not my hands. They're Jeanette's hands or somebody else's hands. So I lift up my skirt and I'm going to do what I have to do. And I look down and I see this hand. And for 10 seconds, I was in a different place.
Well, Frank comes back to the makeup room. And he's in a total other zone. I'm like, Frank, are you okay? What's the matter? And he says to me, JG. Now I understand why some guys dress up like broads.
It was a shocking moment. It really was a reality. I mean, I didn't expect it to do that. See what fun you have doing movies?
Can you talk about process when you're doing improvisation, like with Scorsese and crew, from take to take, when you're doing something 18 different times, what kind of information do you glean and do you learn from take to take to really explore the scene you're trying to...
Well, the improvisation period usually takes place before you do the thing 8 times. You do the thing 8 times after you've come to the set and talked it over about what you're going to do and where the camera's going to be and the dialogue, if there's something you want to change or he wants to change, and the position of the camera. So the 8 times that you're going to do it is not necessarily because of actors. There's a lot of technical things that are involved in shooting a scene. I mean, there's a camera, you gotta hear it, you gotta see it, the lighting's gotta be right. So a lot of times those eight takes are because of the technicians. There's 4 or 5 takes of the technicians. But that happens. It's the camera wasn't focused right. There's a lot of things, there's a lot of details involved in film acting that you have to know to technique of what it's about. It's a very, very, everybody has to, when somebody says, I'm the wardrobe designer, and then it ain't about the wardrobe, it's about everything that we're going to do, the actors, the singing, the dancing, the whatever. It's an effort that everybody has to put it together. So after you get what he wants in terms of where he's going to shoot it from, how he's going to shoot it, how he's going to move the camera, then you have to do it for real to get the shot. Once he gets the shot, it might be the second time we did it, he says, cut, print it, it's in. It's his decision to make. You understand that? So the rehearsal and all that stuff comes first. You set it up the way he wants to see it, or I'll say maybe I should stand on this side, John, or whatever. Then once you get that organized, then it's the shot.
Yes, and way in the back.
Yeah, I think someone mentioned Jersey Shore earlier, and my question is, when the show came out, there was a lot of controversy about the typical stereotypes of Italian Americans in the media. Obviously, you perform, and a lot of your characters are Italian Americans. Did you ever feel that in any of your roles? And what's your take on Italian Americans in the media today?
You slowed this party down, didn't it? Flagger. Don't play politics.
He's
from you? He's from you? No, they were trying to take Sopranos off TV for 10 years. They couldn't do it. They tried every year. I resent the fact that the people don't like it. You have the option to turn the TV off and don't watch it. Simple as that. If you don't like the movie, you don't like it. If you don't want to watch huge monsters, don't watch it. If you don't want to watch rappers, don't watch them. It's the same, it's like anything else. We're portraying people that actually did what they did. I mean, not that it's all necessarily really history, but it's a part of the culture that exists, and there's people that are like that. I mean, all over. Everybody wants to be a wise guy and a tough guy. Everybody. Hey, my cousin's connected. Well, hold the plug, all right.
Of all the directors that you've had the pleasure to work with, if Martin Scorsese is your favorite, who would be your second favorite?
John Gallagher. Amazing, I just got hit here. I'm going to tell you my famous producer in about 2 minutes. Tony, nice Sicilian guy from Connecticut.
Oh, man.
I had a question about a film you did that doesn't get a lot of press, but it's one of my all-time favorites. It was called Ten Benny.
Oh yeah!
Shot that with a young Adrian Brody.
That was his maiden voyage, I think. Adrian, one of his first voyages.
And I was just wondering how that came about because you don't hear a lot about that film, but I thought it was one of your best roles as far as a break from the norm.
The writer got in touch with me on that. It's a long time. We shot it in New Jersey, and
did you shoot that in Bloomfield?
Yeah.
I'm from Nutley.
You're from Nutley? Where in Nutley?
9 Newman Ave.
You know what that is?
Newman Ave, right around the corner.
No, I just...
I'm from Nutley.
You live in Nutley.
Don't start asking me questions.
Seriously?
I live in Nutley.
I went to school.
I didn't go to school, though. I wouldn't go to school in Nutley. Ten Benny, I don't really even... I remember the writer was a nice kid. I met him through somebody else, and I got the script, and Adrian Brody was good in that. That was his first. I don't know what happened to Adrian. He went a little. He went a little weird.
He had the Oscar curse.
He kissed somebody at the Oscars. Who was it that he kissed?
Halle Berry.
Oh yeah, I love to kiss. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Me?
Yeah. No. Come on.
Frank, you were great. I got my SAG card because of, well, a bunch of people. Years ago, we did a movie called Last Request over in Jersey.
Last Request.
And
a few other locations. And Buddy was involved in that too. Buddy, your friend.
Yeah, he was involved, slightly.
But I remember...
Produced it, directed it, wrote it. He was involved.
He was great. But I remember I asked you for some simple advice about what can an actor do to get more work, and you just said, look, just get the gigs.
Just what?
You just said, get the gigs. And I go, oh, okay,
that's good advice. How are you going to do that? You don't know. Is that done? You know how that's done? What is your name?
Mike.
Mike, you know how that's done? Just like we're doing here now. You talk to people, you met somebody, I know Bobby a long time, I know this one, I know that one, I know John Gallagher's doing a project, has me in mind. And you know, the agents are agents, but they wrote the movie for me. I mean, it's just stuff that it comes about and you have to be able to take advantage of it. You have to see opportunity. And you have to be aggressive about that. It's very important because it's a very, very, very difficult bastard business. Everybody's looking to kill talent. Talent gets beat up all the time. All right, now sit down.
All right.
All right, tell us about Chicago Overcoat. It's coming out on DVD. Tell us a little bit how you got involved with that.
Chicago Overcoat was written for me. I found out after I met with the people, and these are two of the young producers right here. They sent the script to me, I read it, I loved it, and we got in touch, and Chris Charles came out to Jersey with the wardrobe lady and the director, Brian Conter, and we had a meeting, and I tried wardrobe on, and we made a date, and we exchanged money, and that's very important to exchange money, folks, because a lot of people are making movies and they have no money, but they want to have a meeting. And they want to have dinner, and they want to take you out here, take you out. But where is the money? In order to make a movie, you've got to put up money. And you can buy cash, you can pay and play, deals, whatever. Anyway, so I went to Chicago. Now I want to tell you what happens when you go to Chicago. I have a thing in my contract that says I have this particular kind of housing. Now this is their first movie. These kids are all under 25, 26 years old. The entire crew and cast. I get to Chicago, the limousine picks me up. I meet my assistant, she comes in the car. I get the cat in the car. When we go to a hotel, I said, I can't stay in this hotel. Okay, let's get a different hotel. Back in the car we go. We went to another hotel. I can't stay in this hotel. It's not what we said we were gonna do. I need an apartment. I'm gonna be here 4 months. I'm not gonna live in a hotel. You can't live in a hotel for 4 months. That's the first day. Okay, so we finally got, and they put me up in a hotel. These are the problems you have. I'm not saying that specifically. They put me up in a hotel for a week, I think a week, and then they gave me they put a condo together. My wife had to go pick out all the furniture. So, and then the next day, the day after I had to shoot, and I get on the set, there's all kids. I said, what the hell am I doing here? All 25-year-old kids. I'm in the business longer than two of them put together. And they're very friendly, and they're very knowledgeable, and before I know it, we make relationships, and I understand what they're doing, they understand what I'm doing, and we made a terrific, terrific movie. And it was a thrill to do, and I would do it anytime for them, anywhere, any place. Not because they're sitting here, they owe me money. That's nothing to do with it. We're having a little CD. The DVD was released the 19th. It's on all the Netflix and all over the Netbox and all over the internet. We got a lot of press because of it, and it's really a good film. We got some good reviews. You see the reviews? We got some good reviews, and it's a nice movie. I play the lead in the movie. I kill everybody. I got a daughter. I always have daughters, and I have a little son. The scene you saw with the boy with the machine gun. So I said to him, what do you want to be when you grow up, a movie star? He said, I am a movie star. I pulled his ear, I said, come over here. But we had a great time in Chicago. I love Chicago. We were there for 2 months. I'd go back anytime, except in the winter. So Chicago Overcoat, I think, is going to be a big movie for us, and we're happy that it's happening, because we're going right from there to Fickle. I understand there's a new project. Joanne gave it up, so. You don't guess me, Melissa. Theo's gonna come and talk to you.
Yeah. Do you have any upcoming projects for like theater or stage or any
variety? No. Don't do theater. Don't do stage. No money. I want to tell you a story, okay? I had the opportunity to do a play directed by my very dear friend John Gallagher, which co-starred my other dear friends Vincent Pastore and another dear friend by the name of Dominic by the name of. Tony Sirico, okay? Now we had a little theater on West Bank Theater, where it was half of this, and you had to go backstage because there was no backstage. We had to get backstage before the people came in because they would have seen us entering the stage. So we're behind the stage for half an hour. Now we're behind the stage in half an hour, and we're just looking at each other, it's dark. I gotta tell you,
in the cup.
He's got a pee. So we said to the production assistant, oh, get a bottle over here. So she became the pee assistant.
funny routine.
Right?
Funny routine.
That was the first time I think you worked with Vinny Pastore, because he replaced Ron McComb.
That's right, yeah. He overacted one time, I said, with the newspaper.
Yeah,
our friend Vinny, he's in California now. He's doing a reality show with the one from Jersey Housewives.
Great. Vitticolicchio.
Victor. My wife, Frank, I saw Chicago Overcoat about three times. Bravo to your performance.
Thank you. But, he's a producer, another producer, casting director.
Yeah, at least three times I've seen it. But what was the first movie you did with John?
The Street Hunter.
Yeah.
Street Hunter, and then we did... Ben Lai, the Deli.
Penance.
Oh, that was, yeah.
Vinny D.
Yeah,
and the hits keep rolling on.
Yeah.
That was with Street Hunter. That was with John Leguizamo, right?
Yeah.
Yes, and the guy who died.
Steve James.
Steve James, the muscle guy. Yeah, we have history.
A little bit. Yeah, so you? Is that Bob?
I love your book, A Guy's Guide to Being a Man's Man.
Who is that over there? Who is that?
You mean this book?
Yes, that book. Yes, sir.
Great book.
It's a fantastic book, sir. What led you to write the book?
Him and I did a couple of Marblehead videos. They're on YouTube. Stand up and take a bow. My man. Rick Steven. Is Steven here? Is Steven Prejean? Get up. Stand up. My co-author, Steven. There he is. What made me do the book? Okay. Steven was writing a book for one of the other Sopranos. And he interviewed me for that book, Tony Lip, right? Tony Lip's book, cookbook. He interviewed me for it. He said to me during the interview, he said, "Do you have a book in you?" And I said, "Yeah, I think I do," because we did Vinny D. We wrote the script. That's it was right. Biographical.
Absolutely.
You know, so I said, "Yeah, we do have a book," and it was right during the time of the Soprano heyday, which was a good time to put out a book because the publishers, what do they know? You know. They think you're popular, they give you a book, they give you an advance. So Stephen and I had dinner, and we walked out of the restaurant, and the guy was in the car, he said, "Hey, Frank, you're the man." So Stephen said to me, "That's the name of the book, Man's Man." And we put the book together, and Stephen did a magnificent job, and we made quite a few dollars from Penguin Books. And it was fun to be a published author. You're a published author.
Absolutely, yes.
We don't fool around, man. You gotta take the opportunity. You gotta take the opportunity. Don't be afraid.
You can pick it up on Amazon.
I pick it up on Amazon, right.
$11.99.
Buddy, it's money.
Yes, so yes.
Frank, is it true that you were asked to be on Sopranos a lot sooner before you actually...
I auditioned for the first go around, which we didn't know. We thought it was a movie about singers. Tony Sirico, myself, and Dominic Chanice. There wasn't even a role for Tony Sirico. We all read Dominic's part. They hired Dominic to play Uncle Junior, and they wrote a role for Tony to play Paulie Walnuts, and he didn't hire me. He didn't hire me because I just came off Goodfellas, and he didn't want anybody that was that well known at that time to be on the shows to take away from the characterization. And he called me back 2 years later. He said, "We're going to do something." And I had Tony, every time he ran into David, say, "What about Frank? What about Frank?" And all my friends, I came on the third year, they hired me. And you see, David Chase knew all the while what he was doing. He knew where the arc was going to go. He knew that Johnny Sachs was going to die. He knew he had to replace Johnny Sachs. And it's amazing that you think somebody could be that genius. But he was absolutely that genius. He took me in the third season. I wasn't a regular. I was only
reoccurring.
Because they save a little money that way. You're reoccurring. They only pay you for the shows you did. Then you fight with them the next year. And then you get a regular. And you get paid for every show, even if you don't do it. But David knew that Phil Deotardo was going to come in. He knew it. He went out with his head being crushed. Yeah, Nick. Oh, by the way, you saw Nick, my friend Nick Puccio's here. We did what's the movie with Dominic, where the priest?
Under
Hellgate Bridge.
That was Hellgate. Yeah, Nick was in the scene with us.
You know, I would be remiss if I didn't say this about Frank. We go back a lot of years. He's responsible for my career. I was a singer, cabaret singer. Frank put me in my first movie with Pesci, because I knew Joe for years. It was Casino. And this man is the kindest, most generous actor in the business. And I know a lot of him, and he knows that. I have to say that. He's been just marvelous to me. And he's my brother. He's just wonderful.
Thanks, Nick. That was Sicilian for you. That was Sicilian for you.
Let me second that again, but, you know, I mean, my experience with Frank,
you know, we made this picture called Men Lie. It cost $100,000, shot in 11 days. Frank and I had already worked a couple times before that. It was all new actors, all very, very good actors, many of whom have gone to stellar careers. I never got once from Frank, oh, who's this guy? I gotta do the scene with this guy? Who is he? No. He worked with him and he elevated their work.
That's right.
Just by being in the scene with them. On top of that, he was very, very good with locations. I mean, 11-day shoot.
Yeah.
In Nutley, he says, you know, we're looking for this place, that place. He's like, this is my health club in Nutley. Come take a look. We took a look. We got 9 locations. The 2 offices, 2 restaurants, a bar, the gym, the, you know. So, absolutely. And again, all the pictures that you've done, you know, with the independent stuff, I mean, North End, and I mean, the list goes on and on. IMDb is full of them.
I did the North End with him.
Yeah, right.
That's one of the finest. You have to see that film if you haven't seen it. He played Don DeBella, and it was Tony Darrow,
and you,
Frank and I. And Frank really, I mean, he shined.
Had fun doing that.
That was a wonderful.
Yeah, that's very rare. Even in the deli, you know, we had a mix of. I like to use, you know, new people, a mix of new people and established people. And again, when the new people work with them. You know, he just they're elevated by working with him, and that's what I'm giving a lot of credit for discovering people, launching people. A lot of that has to do with the people I put them in the film with. You know, including Frank. Anybody else? Nick.
Yes, Frank. I want to tell you something that I talk to John on the phone every night, and even behind your back, he says nice things about you.
You're a lonely guy.
I know, I feel very lucky.
No, John's a good man.
He is, he's brilliant.
John and I, we are friends, first and foremost.
Yeah.
And it's a pain in the ass to have a director as a friend.
It is, but it's worth it.
We work good together. We understand each other. We wrote scripts together. Just make it as easy as you can. People make too much out of it sometimes. They overreact to different things, which my guys here from Chicago know about. Especially young directors, they get brutalized by actors.
Yeah.
You know, the actors think that I'm here, and what are you going to tell me? But you can't do that. You have to be right with them.
But he says the most wonderful things.
I know. It's
Nick Crooks.
Nick Crooks. Thanks, Nick.
Brooks. Yes, Becky.
Karen, my publicist is here, sweetheart. For many, many years, Karen Fedorock is here.
I have a question, actually, I've never asked you. The ending to The Sopranos was considered very controversial by the press, the whole fade to black. Many people had different thoughts about what the actual ending was. Do you have a theory of what you think that meant?
Everybody had that same problem at the end of Sopranos. Everybody thought that the TV went off because it went to black, and everybody had, you know, most people didn't like the ending. They were disappointed on the ending, but if you think about the ending, he left it wide open in case he wanted to do something else. First of all, yeah, right. So and I thought it was a genius ending. I mean, but. Everybody does have a voice about that, Karen. They do, and everybody's got a different opinion of it. And you know what? That's what makes it work. I mean, you got people talking about it all over and discussing it at the
4 years later.
Yeah, how many years later? Right, exactly.
Yes, one more.
I don't know. I thought running over, just to elaborate on what you were saying on this last question, I thought running over Phil's head was really the one indulgence of the episode, where, you know, the audience really wanted to see something like that happen to your character. But I also felt like, okay.
Let me tell you about Phil's being run over, okay? Phil was always referred to as the Shah of Iran among Tony's crew. They always said it's the Shah. It's the guy with the gray hair. They always talked about Phil's hair. So how are you going to kill him? You got to run him the head over. And the funny thing is, we had those little babies in the car. There were two little babies in the back seat of the car. There was actually 3. They had 3 triplets. So they only used 2 at a time. That's some rules they had for babies. And the very first take, well, they have to have a spare. The father dropped one, though. He really did. They had to take it to the hospital. I swear to God. It really happened. It really happened. And that's, you know, movie sets are crazy places. And these kids are crying like brats, you know. Anyway, so the first take, I'm in the car, and I'm turning around and saying to the kids, say bye-bye to Pop-Pop. Say bye-bye to Pop-Pop. David says, cut. Sorry, David. He says, they're 2 years old. They can't talk. Wave bye-bye to Pop-Pop. Oh, okay. Well, who never, I didn't think of it. Wave to wave. So that's what happened. That's just a little aside. Yes.
My perception of the ending of The Sopranos was you're just watching these people's lives up to this point, and now all of a sudden they're cut off. You're not watching their lives anymore. Fade to black.
Well,
I thought it was kind of brilliant.
Yeah, it was absolutely brilliant. They said that was Tony going to get killed in the car, you know, and she was trying to park the car. She had one of those cars that parks itself. Nobody knows that. The car that she had, you know, when you turn the wheel, the car parks itself. It does. When the daughter was coming in, then you saw the other guys come in. I thought they were going to whack Tony. So it had a lot of suspense. And he just took it away from you.
Yes, back there?
Yeah. If you're going to tell somebody how to make a good gangster movie, what to do, what not to do, what would you say?
How to make a good gangster movie. If someone's going to make a gangster movie, how would you say to them how to make a good one? What to do, what not to do?
Be a good gangster is to be very quiet and be small. Don't be big, because gangsters, real gangsters, are not big. They fear them because of the way they look at you. You know that they are capable of doing anything that they want to do, and they will do anything they want to do. I've met a lot of people that do that. And there's a story where I was having dinner with my wife and my brother, who came in from Florida, and another couple, and we went into this restaurant, and sitting right across from us with four people was one of the biggest bosses in New Jersey, a real lunatic man. Waved to me, I said, hi Bob, how are you? Good, how are you? Went over the table, I paid my respect. Sat down, we're eating. My brother got a headache, so I'm gonna go wait in the car for a minute. I'm just gonna lay down. I said, okay. Now Bob was talking and he said something about Hollywood. I said, yeah, that was funny. He said, what? He said, come in. I got up and I went to the table. He says, in fact, let me tell you something. I'll leave you right here where you're standing. Who do you think you are interrupting my conversation? Now, this comes from simply envy. Because when I first came in, he said to me, who are you with? I said, I'm with these people, but you don't know them. He really knew them. Now, I took the decision to stay here, tell him he didn't know him. So it's a very, very complicated situation. When Joe Pesci says, do I make you laugh? How do I make you laugh? What's funny about me that you laugh? That really happened. That's the same guy that I had to run in. But they are capable. So he didn't scream, he didn't holler at me. He just looked at me. He said, come here, let me talk to you. I will leave you right here where you're standing in 2 seconds. And it's the truth. That's the way they are. And that's how you put it. You never saw a mob boss screaming and hollering. That's bullshit. They're all low-key. Like I know.
Well, we want to. One more.
What do you got against mulattoes?
I'm sorry, brother. I heard you before. Can't stand mulattoes.
All my life, I thought I was black.
No, well, you got white blood in you, brother. You ain't like black. That guy's black.
We all got white blood.
We all have white blood?
And black blood.
Security. I know. I have nothing against mulattoes. I'm very anti. What's the word? I'm you're having fun. You're a good sport. You have a few left. I want to thank you all very, very much. My dear friends.
Ladies and gentlemen, at 9:20, Michael Imperioli's directorial debut, The Hungry Ghosts, is screening with Steve Sciarippa and Sharon Angela. Excellent film, stay right there. Thank you.
Thank you all, guys, once again for coming to the Soul Motion Festival 2019.